essence.
All rise. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. Lord, on days when everything seemed to go wrong, help us to remember that you are always nearby to offer comfort. It's easy to get overwhelmed and feel lost and alone in this world, but deep down we know that is never the case. You are always ready to help us. We just need to remember a moment to stop, breathe, and pray. Comfort me, O Lord, as I seek shelter from the storms of everyday life. I'm grateful for the good I have, but sometimes I feel that the burden that I have to carry is a challenge that may be alone. When this happens, remind me that no, I'm never alone. Remind me with your loving presence that no matter what my day brings me, you are there for me. You are there with me and on my behalf, making smooth the way before me. In your love, I find rest. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Lord, what comfort we find in your changeless nature when we look back and remember all the ways you've guided us in the past. We know we have no need to be anxious about the future. You were, you are, and you will always be our Savior and Lord. So why should we fear instability when you are always here with us? Even when we lose our loved ones, you are here to remind us that there is a better day a coming. You say, comfort ye my people, saith your God. I am he that liveth and was dead, and I am alive forevermore. That's what Jesus said. So we can be sure that all those who die in Christ shall be raised again. And I can assure you, it's sooner than most of us think. And so as we begin this celebration, we just want to pray that God will keep reminding us that death is not the end. Elder McCoy?
Let us pray. Well, be seated. Oh, we shall pray. Heavenly Father, these are difficult times, but we are not afraid. We know who you are. You know who we are. We know that you are a God who covers our shortcomings with the power of your blood. But more than that, you walk with us, and you talk with us, and you tell us we are your own. The McAdoo family needs to know that they are, we are your own. We belong to you. And so as we go through this service today, there will be difficult moments. There will be difficult days ahead, but the Holy Spirit walks with us every step of the way. And so we pray for this family, and we pray for us, because in this church, we are all family. We may not be related, but we're family. And we come together at a time like this to be supportive. So give us the words to speak, so that all of our hearts will be encouraged. We thank you for the life of Brother Billy McAdoo. Happy that we can come and celebrate his life here today. And we thank you that he's been a part of all that we have done all these years here in the Nashville area. Now bless us to know the peace that passes right by all understanding, and give us comfort, because we ask it in the name of the Father, of your Son, Jesus the Christ, Son of the living God. Amen.
The program is outlined. I think everyone has a program. Are there individuals who don't have a program? Okay. Ushers, can you help us? Hold your hands up. The ushers will serve you. With the program being outlined as it is, it will follow as written unless I'm informed of changes. We thank God for all those who are serving today. May we have a celebration in Jesus' name.
to be, but a little rain,
a little rain
mixed with bright sunshine, a little pain,
a little pain
helps me appreciate the good times.
Amen, amen. We need to be grateful. God has been so good. Elder McAdoo, elder of my church, head elder for a long time. He used to call me his partner in crime. I told him, I don't think that we ought to say that. But he and I, we've done many things together. He's been the head. We've done many things together. We did men's mission, men's ministry, week of prayer, men's week of prayer, things that we've done together. One thing that we've done together as elders was funerals. Old, New Testament. I'm going to really miss my partner in crime. But God is good.
I've heard of many Old Testament scriptures, mainly the Psalms, 23rd Psalms, walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I haven't heard of this one, but Mia told me that she would like for me to do this one here. It's come from Lamentations chapter 3. We're going to look at verse 22 through 26 and then 31 through 33. It was interesting, and I think it's fitting at this time. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassion faileth not. They are renewed every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, saith my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good unto them that wait for him, to the soul that seeketh him. It is good that a man should both hope and quietly wait for the salvation of the Lord. Go to verse 31 to 33. For the Lord will not cast off forever. But though he cause grief, yet will he have compassion according to the multitude of his mercy. For he does not afflict willingly, nor grieve the children of men.
Good afternoon. Some of you may have noticed when I came in that I was using a cane. That's so I wouldn't fall, okay? But it's significant about that cane. It doesn't belong to me. It belongs to him. You see, we had the same cane. We were using the same cane in church, me and Elder McAdoo. And we would get them mixed up. Because if we were in the multipurpose room eating dinner and what have you, I always made it my business to sit at the table where he was. And we would often mix our canes up. So the cane that I'm using today belongs to Billy McAdoo. No, you can't have it. Okay. I want to let you know that. I had a special name for Elder McAdoo. I'm going to share it with you. Dapper Dan. And some of you older people know why I called him Dapper Dan. He was always on point. I don't care where he went, what kind of event it was, he'd be suited up and tied down. Yes, he would. He had such royal elegance about him. I'm like, look at you, Dapper Dan. So when I am given this privilege to really pay tribute and honor to someone I thought was special. You see, I met him over here at Hillcrest back in the day. Yeah. Yeah. He was the same then as he was the last time I saw him. That was him, y'all. But he set the bar high. For some of you, just saying. This man was on point, but beyond that, on earthly standards, this man has a place in the kingdom. I can call that. Now, I'm not one who just says stuff. I can call that. His life was indicative of that. So I can say, you know, when the question is asked, is my name written there? I can answer for him, yep, it's there, Dapper Dan. So I've been asked to share this bit of scripture with you. And I want to dedicate this in his honor to the family. It's taken from the book of John, chapter 14. I'm going to read to you verses 1 through 3. The Bible I'm reading from, the version I'm reading from, is the Life Recovery Bible. He was always about making a difference in somebody's life. And I thought this was right on point to read from this version. And it reads as follows. Don't be troubled. I'm going to repeat that because you need to hear it. Don't be troubled. You trust God. Now trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's home, and I'm going to prepare a place for you. If this were not so, folk, my pod, I would tell you so. If this were not so, I gotta say it again to you. I would tell you so. But it's true. And then it goes on to say, when everything is ready, I think that's us. When everything is ready, I will come and get you. That's the way it reads here. So that you will always be with me where I am. And you know where I'm going and how to get there. Follow his example. Thank you.
You know, people that are normally known as Billy were originally named William. But Billy McAdoo has always been Billy because Billy is a term of endearment. Every William that you know and liked and loved, you called Billy. So we're here to celebrate his life. And I understand that a superlative describes the highest degree of quality. And when you decide to talk about Billy McAdoo, you will run out of superlatives as a father, as a Christian, as a church worker, emphasis on worker. Dedication, commitment to an assignment, and dissatisfaction with himself if he didn't do it excellently. And so that's why we are here today. And I want to say to this family, we don't know how to say the right words all the time, but you look in our faces and you will know that we are with you during this period. And we've asked the Lord to freeze frame our faces in your minds. Not that we're good looking or pretty, but when this day is over and everybody's gone their several ways, I hope the Holy Spirit will play back for you, show you our faces. And when you see them, know that we are praying with you and for you, so that you do not go through this valley alone. God bless you. Be of good cheer. And like the Holy Spirit, we try not to be very far away. Be with you and be blessed.
Good afternoon. The family of Billy McAdoo would like to extend our heartfelt thanks and appreciation to all who have shown their love, support, and sympathy during this time. We hope you each remember him for his kindness, generosity, and infectious smile, and the love he shared with everyone he encountered. Thanks to all those who provided support and comfort to him. Special thanks to the pastors and church members of New Life and Hillcrest SDA churches. Also, thanks to musician Terrence Brown and Cedric Thomason for the video presentation. Dear McAdoo family, the F.H. Jenkins Preparatory School Board was deeply saddened to hear the passing of longtime board member, Elder Billy McAdoo. Please accept our heartfelt condolences during this difficult time. Losing someone you love is never easy, but praise God for the hope that he will come again for his children. Elder McAdoo served as a faithful member of the F.H. Jenkins School Board and had a passion for seeing young people taught of the Lord. Elder McAdoo contributed valuably to the strategic vision and direction of the school, always focused on excellence for today and for tomorrow. His contributions will always be cherished by those whose lives he touched. While nothing can ease the pain of his absence, may the memories you share bring you comfort and solace in the days ahead. The good news for all of us is what the Word of God says. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command and with the voice of an archangel and the trump call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord forever. We encourage you today with these words. Please know that the McAdoo family is in our thoughts and prayers. With deepest sympathy and love, Summer Woods, Principal, and F.H. Jenkins Preparatory School family. In loving memory of Elder Billy Dell McAdoo. The peaceful sunset of the life of Billy Dell McAdoo came on Saturday evening, March 9, 2024, surrounded by his family. We, the pastor, the board, and the entire membership of the New Life SDA Church, Nashville, Tennessee, extend to the family, friends, and colleagues and former students of our beloved Elder Billy Mack our sincere condolences and prayer in this your time of sorrow. We mourn with you for our beloved brother and friend who faithfully attended and served New Life SDA Church for many years. It is our prayer that you can rely upon the beautiful memories to comfort you as you experience moments of grief. Be assured that this great loss will be present in all of us with a flood of emotion and memories. Elder McAdoo's influence and presence was powerful to us in New Life. With simple gestures, his huge and warm smile, his flair of dress, his handshake hugs, his wise advice provided so many of us with confidence, stability, inspiration, love, reassurance, and hope. To experience him was certainly a joy and honor. Our many great pastors would come and go, but Elder McAdoo was a one constant presence to so many of us for a very long time. Elder McAdoo was an accomplished educator. However, we know his greatest and happiest accomplishments were personal moments shared with those in his personal village. Elder McAdoo absolutely adored his children, grandchildren, all of his family, and his church family. We lift his personal village up in our thoughts and prayers. Thank you, family, for sharing him with us. Let it be known that we cannot replace Elder McAdoo, but each of us can attempt to improve our lives and the lives of those with whom we come in contact with, as demonstrated by the great example of Elder McAdoo. Finally, dear friends and family, We know your loss is deep and your sorrow is great, but we want you to know that we share your sorrow. We're praying for you, and most importantly, we recognize this loss is but temporary as we await the arrival of our Lord and Savior. At this time, the Bible tells us to encourage one another with the words of 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18. In that day, your tears of sorrow will be turned into tears of praise as we greet one another in that celestial city. We have that blessed hope. Prayerfully and lovingly submitted, Elder Aaron Dyer, Pastor, New Life SDA Church. Resolution in loving memory of Elder Billy Dell McAdoo. There is a hush in our hearts as we come together to pay our respects to the memory of Elder Billy Dell McAdoo. According to his tender mercy, God, who is infinite in his wisdom, has seen fit to remove from our midst our beloved brother in Christ by means of death on Saturday, March 9, 2024. Death, be not proud, though some have called thee mighty and dreadful, for thou art not so. Whereas Billy was a son, brother, husband, father, and grandfather, whereas our brother accepted Christ at an early age and was baptized at Meharry Seventh-day Adventist Church and was among the first constituents of Hillcrest Seventh-day Adventist Church, whereas our brother worked with Pastor Henry Holt and other elders to conduct the Youth for Better Living effort, it became the foundation for the establishment of the New Life Seventh-day Adventist Church. Whereas our brother served as the first elder for New Life for many years and continued to be a faithful servant in the New Life Church and community until recently. Whereas our brother was a football star at Cameron High School and graduated in 1959. Whereas our brother was proud to have attended church school and made sure that his children and grandchildren attended and graduated from F.H. Jenkins Elementary School. Whereas our brother was so firmly dedicated to his vision for Christian education, he not only served as a member of the F.H. Jenkins School Board, he was also the chairman for several years. Whereas our brother received his Bachelor of Science degree from Tennessee State University, as well as a Master of Arts degree from Fisk University, whereas our brother served the Metropolitan Nashville Public School System for 40 years and was awarded the title of Teacher of the Year several times, whereas our brother touched the future by pouring confidence, compassion, and love of science and biology into the hearts and minds of young people who are blessed to cross his path of inspiration. Whereas our brother was devoted to his family, he was known as the photographer and videographer who captured precious memories. Whereas our brother enjoyed his variety of exotic and everyday pets. Whereas our brother was devoted to his family, friends, and to his Lord and Savior. Whereas our Heavenly Father, he has written Billy's final lesson plans of life. He's taken down his bulletin boards of sacrifice. He solidified his keys of leadership, and he's closed his grade book of excellence. The family accepts the will of a sovereign God in the passing of their loved one. Therefore, be it resolved that we embrace the family because we all have a common bond that will connect us for the remainder of our lives. We cannot replace Mac, but we can attempt to demonstrate his love for Christ in his worth ethic, his devotion to his family, his work for the church, his dedication to Christian education, as well as his unfailing faith in the promises of our Lord and Savior. Be it further resolved that while our sorrow is profound, we have the promise of the Lord that the clouds of mourning will fade away and the sun will shine on us again. In that bright light, we will feel the warmth of God's promise to those of us who are children of the light. And remember, Mia, and Samia, the things he did, the things he said, were the gentle rays of hope that touched us all each day. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with a cry of command, and the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trump of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and we will always be with the Lord. Humbly submitted, Hillcrest Seventh-day Adventist Church, Robert Lister, Pastor.
There are a couple of adjustments. I remember one time when we had a funeral and seemed like everybody was taking as much time as they wanted to take. And when I stood up, I was told, remember, it's just 2 minutes, 2 minutes. So we've reached that point where we need to remind those who are coming afterwards. It's 2 minutes, and we do have a very important schedule because this is Sunday, and the graveyard closes at a certain time, so we need to honor that 2 minutes. Steve is here. He's going to come, and after Steve, all those who are listed under reflections after Elder Joseph McCoy will come, and please respect the time. Thank you. Thank you.
How y'all doing? All right. First of all, I'd like to thank Miss Diane Ketchin for singing that Be Grateful song, because I was really grateful that Brother McAdoo was in my life. You know, you got to be grateful. If he was grateful if he was grateful in your life, you got to give it a round of applause, because I experienced it. I'm talking about some real stuff here. See, look, we called him Brother Mac. See, before Bernie Mac, we had Billy McAdoo, a.k.a. Elder Mac. See, he always pulled me in. I remember Brother McAdoo used to come in the projects. When I was 12 years old, we had an evangelist and stuff, and I ended up, my mama pulled us up there, and we had to join the Seventh-day Adventist Church. I didn't know if it was the world was coming to an end or what, but I knew that I didn't want to go to church on Saturdays because my cartoons and all of it, she messed up all that stuff. But nevertheless, Billy McAdoo, Brother Elder Mac would come over there with a two-door red car and pick up five people. I do not understand how we all got in that car, but he would come and pick us up. And when he came to pick us up, he would laugh. And y'all know that laugh he used to give you? That joke would laugh. He always was pointing at you. I'm telling you, this is the real Billy Mac that I knew. I remember Mr. Billy McAdoo started, you know, trying to teach us Pathfinders. We had all the wrong colors on. It was two people in the group. It was terrible. But he taught me how to tie a string, you know, a rope. He knew how to do the science part of the of Pathfinders. But one thing he did, I call him pull. He will always pull you in. See, you got to know what pull is. Pull, Brother Mac has patience with you. He had understanding, and he listened. That's pull. He always pulled me in. He pulled me in because he would always listen to me, and he never was judgmental. He had patience, understanding, listening. I know as a kid, you know, I didn't really understand, but he was just showing me how to be a man. And to this day, I'm still in church because of Brother Elder Billy Mac. You know, so I know this, my 2 minutes is up, and I'm going to pass the mic to Miss Felicia.
My 2 minutes starts right now, okay, because he went over, okay? All right, well, I come on behalf of our prayer line sisters. The first thing I want to say is, anybody know what Father's Day is? You know, Father's Day was invented just for him. He was the best father that I have seen since I've been with Mia since F.A. Jenkins. The best, right here, the best father. And so I looked at Mia's mom, and I mimicked her, and I look at him in awe of how he loved Mia. He loved you, Shay. He loved these grandkids. I mean, would give his world for you guys. So I have three Bible promises. We started our prayer line, sister, for a friend, for a sister. And so our promises, we got three Bible texts. And Mia, Shay, when you're worried, this is what we've learned. 1 Peter 5:7 says, cast all your cares upon him because he cares for you. Me and Shay, when you guys are anxious, Philippians 4:6-7 says, do not be anxious for nothing, but in every situation, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God will transcend all, not some, all understanding, and it will guard your heart and mind in Jesus Christ. And the last thing, Mia and Shay, if you guys ever are afraid, if you guys are ever dismayed, if you guys are weak, Joshua 1:9 says, have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee wherever thou goest. Mia, Shay, he's resting. But God, he's still sitting here right beside you guys. He got you. Mia, you know the prayer line sisters, we got you. We have always been there. And we're going to continue to be there for you. Amen. Thank you.
Two minutes. Theodore Inslee, is he here? If he's here, would you please? I was supposed to say that before I started to speak. When you've been somebody's friend for 70 years, let me tell you how Billy Mack and Preston Brown became friends. Billy Mack came to Meharry when he was 13, when we were 13. And we became friends at the age 13. Fast forward, Mia, to 17. Our plans were he was going to be a doctor and I was going to see the world. So at 17, he went to college and I went in the military. I stayed in the military 12 years. During that time, when I'd come home, where we met was in church. His mother and my mother made sure that we were in church. We could, y'all probably didn't know this in those years, we could be in the club when we were in school. But our parents said this, if you couldn't go to club, you can go to church. So we went to Meharry, and then we came here. But let me tell you something about Billy. Billy was always a good friend. We didn't spend a whole lot of time together, but we were best friends. You say, how could that happen? Well, when we saw each other, we could pick up where we left off. And when we got married, we knew we needed to be in church. And when we had kids, we knew we had to be in church. Now, we were destined to be in church because our brothers, guess what our brothers' names were? James and John. You're going to be in church when your name is James and John. So we became elders, and watch this. He taught biology when he came out of school. I was teaching judo. But we enjoyed ourselves when we became, can you believe this? These two boys that mothers made them come to church, now we're both elders in the church. We wrote our first sermon together. You didn't know that, did you, Mia? Our first sermon was, how come these mountains are still in my life? What we were saying was, how come we're still dealing with some of the same things we were dealing with before we became elders? Then one that was really good to us was, what must I do to be saved? And we recognized that the price had already been paid. Believe in me and in whom was sent me, and thou shalt be saved. It cut all the works out, gave us a shot. We knew then we had a chance. That was my brother. 70 years, we don't call each other friends. We call each other brothers. His greatest love was for his children and his grandchildren. So we made it a point. We talked three things. First thing we did was brag about our children and our grandchildren. Then we talked about the goodness of God. And then we said something to each other. When we left each other, we'd say, we'll talk. Because we didn't know whether it would be next week or the next 5 years. It didn't really matter because we said we'd talk. And I'm here today to tell you, we'll talk.
Good afternoon. When I first read the program and I seen that a branch had fallen off the family tree, I realized a branch had fallen off my friend's tree, which Billy was a great friend of mine. Billy was a great friend of mine. Can you hear me now?
Nope. Is it on?
Hello? Like I said, Billy was a great friend of mine, and we knew each other over 50 years. We knew each other over 50 years. I'm not used to talking on mics, but I'm going to be short. One of the most things that Billy, we always talked about as we were friends, and he talked about his girls. And Billy loved his girls. He loved his grandkids. He wanted to spend all the time that he could with them. And any time the ups or the downs they had, he was always there. He was there when I had my downs in my life. And Billy would always come and say, well, let's pray. And that was very deeply motivating for me to come from a friend like that to ask me to sit down and pray, because I really realized that he was really on my side. He was a Seventh-day Adventist and I was a Baptist, but we had God that we know that we both believed in and that we always look forward to trying to make our lives abide by that. And I've always missed Billy, and like I said, I was so glad that they let me be a part of this and a part of the family. And I just want to say that I always miss Billy, and he was always be in my life, and the family will always be in my life, and whatever I can do, let me know, and I'll always be there. Thank you.
Billy Dell McAdoo, a heartfelt tribute to a beloved father, grandfather, and pillar of the community. Born on October 15th. The life of Billy Dell McAdoo, a heartfelt tribute to a beloved father, grandfather, and pillar of the community. Born on October 15th, 1940, and departed on March 9th, 2024, Billy Dell McAdoo's life story is a testament to love, faith, and community spirit. Join us as we celebrate the legacy of this devoted Christian through a beautifully crafted narrative that honors his memory and touches the hearts of all who knew him. Let us preserve his story for generations to come.
Daddy, it's your daughter Mia. You've been such a great dad, and you've taught me so much. We have shared so many great memories over the years. And you've always been there for me and my family. You've been there to celebrate mostly all of our special occasions and help to make the memories for us. I just remember the next day you coming over, and you'd have a video and pictures, and we would always be so happy to see them. You always helped us with our pets and anything else we needed. It wasn't anything that you couldn't do or fix. You always loved your church and fellowshipping, and we always loved to do that with you as well. You know, it wasn't anything that you wouldn't do for us. In your last days, I did all I could to make sure you were happy and comfortable. I'm sure going to miss you. Just know, you were such a great dad and a granddad. We love you, Mia.
guys. I'm Raven, and I'm Mr. McAdoo's granddaughter. His favorite granddaughter. I'm the only granddaughter. My grandfather was the best grandfather I could ask for. He went above and beyond for me and my family. We did every science project together when I was a kid, and that was our quality time. And I have him to thank for my career choice. I asked my grandfather if he had any advice for me as I entered into my last year of veterinary school, and he said to me, "Follow your dreams and do what God says." I wrote that down so I would never forget it. I live by that every single day, and I'm so grateful for all of his love, support, and prayers over the years. Granddad, I will never forget the impact you had on my life. I love you so much. See you soon.
My name is Rashad Hill. I'm the grandson. He's like the best grandson. He picked me up, take me places, come to all my basketball games, and I know I'll see you back, and I know we will see you in heaven.
Hi, I'm Nantambu Clausel. I am grandson-in-law, married to Raven. I may have only known you for a few years, but you've made an impact in my life by expressing and showing your love for me and being an example of a man and a leader through faith and prayer. I've always appreciated all the love you've shown me and the encouragement you've provided me since day one. For that, I thank you and will take the best care of your granddaughter, Raven. We love you and we miss you.
Mr. McAdoo, it's me, Lil Rick, your firstborn grandson. I just wanted to say thanks for all you showed me. I miss coming to your house and raking the leaves and blowing them off your roof and planting flowers with you and playing with Squeeze. And you showed me how to perfect my tie-tying skills and coming over and talking about science stuff, and I'm just gonna miss you, you know, everything about you, and I'll miss your laugh, and when they used to call me, it used to be like, "Hey, little Ricky, my firstborn grandson, how you doing? I'm gonna really, really miss you, you know, and I love you. See you soon."
The things we say are gentle rays of hope that touch us all each day.
What a life. Praise God. After Diane Ketchins gives musical selection, Pastor McAdoo's, or maybe I should say Elder McAdoo, Elder McAdoo's last pastor, will come, Pastor Aaron Dyer.
A change has come over me.
to the family of Billy McAdoo, to his daughter, Sister Mia, Sister Shay. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. My name is Aaron Dyer, and I am blessed to serve the New Life Church of Seventh-day Adventists right there in Nashville, Tennessee, as lead pastor. And on behalf of the New Life Church family today, I'd like to express my deepest condolences and heartfelt sympathies to you and yours as we grieve and grapple with this new reality. Grateful to be here to celebrate the love and the labor and the life and the legacy of your dear brother and father and friend and our elder, Elder Billy McAdoo. Won't you pray with me today? Father, in Jesus' name, we come before you and we thank you for your unfailing love, your keeping grace, and your perfect peace. You are the everlasting God, our creator, and our friend. And even in this hour, we trust you to be the God of all comfort. And we thank you for your deep, comforting, abiding presence that is with us to support us, sustain us, and soothe us as we struggle with loss today. Father, we thank you for Elder Billy Dell McAdoo. We thank you for his witness. We thank you for his testimony. We thank you for the smiles and the tears we shared with him, for the memories and the moments we created with him. We recognize today, oh God, that all the days ordained for him were written in your book before one of them came to be. And you have watched over him from before his very first breath. We thank you that your loving kindness lasts for a lifetime. Your loving kindness is better than life. And we bless you for your faithfulness to Elder McAdoo in life and for your love for him even in death. You've been a good God to Billy McAdoo. Surely goodness and mercy has followed him all the days of his life. And we believe that because his Redeemer lives, he will experience new life in a better place soon and very soon when we go to see the King. But until then, oh God, send your Holy Spirit to carry us, to cover us, to comfort these his loved ones in the valley of bereavement. In Jesus' name, we pray these things together. And all God's people said, amen and amen and amen.
After we have words of comfort from the Reverend Kenneth Johnson, our musical selection will come in preparation for the eulogy, and we praise God for a great celebration today.
First, I stand to give honor to God because he's the head of my life. Head of everything I do, head of our family. I wish my condolences upon my family. I pray that they will trust in God to get stronger as the days, weeks, and years move forward, because he's able. There's nothing he can't do. But anyway, Billy is my first cousin. His mother and my mother, They were sisters. And one of the things that I loved about that relationship was you did not have to ask where you was going, Thanksgiving or Christmas. One of them had the Thanksgiving dinner, the other one had the Christmas dinner, and we know we was going somewhere to eat some good food. Family would come together. Most of the family would be there, and Billy would be somewhere shooting pictures. I got some very old pictures that I really have enjoyed. But I like to say that Billy was the light of our family. And one of the reasons that he was, him and his brother, they were the first two in our family to finish college. I had seven other brothers and three or four other sisters, but Billy and James were the first two to finish college. I guess my brothers, they took another road. It went shortcut, but anyway, but they were very inspirational to us. And what I'm inspired about is that Billy and James grew up in the projects. Yeah. Jason Apricord, they went through everything that you hear kids now talking about they went through and couldn't make it because they got hindered by drinking. They didn't drink. By smoking, I think Billy smoked for a little while, but he got the idea that smoking wasn't good for him, and so he quit smoking. They didn't gamble. None of them went to jail. She didn't go and get either one of her sons out of jail. But they were model examples of what young Christian men should be. Irene was tough on them. She brought them up, like the Lord said, bring them up in the nurture, admonition of the Lord. She brought them up in the Lord. She taught them the right way, and she expected them to do the right thing. And Billy and James did. They did the right thing. So when you tell me I'm having a hard time because I'm living in the projects, I got two examples. Not one of them made it through. Both of them made it through. And not just people in the world, but Billy was a Christian. He was a Christian man. And so you know the devil was busy, and so he had to fight. He had to fight. I'm not talking about the kind of fight you're talking about. I'm talking about a spiritual battle. Paul said, every time I would do good, evil is always present. But Billy made it through it. He did. And he is a living, a shining example for all of us. Now, I know my 2 minutes is about up. I'm not going to take no longer than that. And I tell you what I did. I had three scriptures, but I cut it down to one. I did. And if I was going to use this, this is the one I would use. Right here for my first cousin. Therefore, coming from 1 Corinthians 15, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, much as you know your labor. Let me say it again. Huh? Because y'all think y'all got something down here in this little world. Huh? But eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither have entered the heart of man the things that God have in store for the ones who love him. He put his work in the right thing. He put a lot of his work in you, and you see that. You've been inspired because of Billy. And because of the work that he did in this world. Billy, your labor is not in vain in the world. Amen. I just want to take one little bonus, and I'm going to go. One thing, Billy wasn't perfect. One thing he missed out on. Don't you laugh, because I must tell you, you're going to say, are you right about that? I did too. Final arrangement planners. That's what that is. a final arrangement because I saw two girls digging hard trying to prepare their father's funeral and arrangements. You got time to prepare your final arrangements. You need to do it. Huh? Because you know one day what? You're going to leave here. And somebody's going to have to do your arrangements. You're going to leave all that work on somebody else. So I was at a planning once, and I got some of these programs. And so I'm just saying, if you see me, members of my family, I have a few of them. And if you want one of them, I give them to you. But they really will help you. Don't say you forgot, or don't wait and say it's too late. Make your arrangements while you have time. Amen? God bless you. God bless you, family. God bless you, church.
People of God, say amen. Let us pray together. Our Father and our God, we come now. We come now, O God, in this time of sadness. We come, O God, with broken hearts. We heard that you were a heart fixer, a mender of broken hearts. So we ask, O God, that you will come now and speak to us as we look into your holy word, look into our lives, and may we find hope and comfort in your word. Speak to me and through me. In Jesus' name, amen. Just want to say to the family, Mia, Shamia, grandchildren, family and friends, on behalf of my wife, myself, we are here with you and for you. And that even after this day has gone, we will still be available to you. Our prayers are with you, and we look forward to the day when the Lord shall bring these occasions to an end. The time is far spent, so just want to share with you one verse from the book of John. John chapter 11 and verse number 11, we find these words. These things said he, talking about Jesus, and after that he said unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of sleep. I just want to talk to you a little while on the subject, waiting on a wake-up call. Waiting on a wake-up call. During my almost 30 years of pastoral ministry, I've been blessed to serve with some of the greatest elders in South Central. One such elder was Elder Billy McAdoo. First met him in the late 80s, after graduating from college and attending New Life Church. Then from 2011 to 2017, I was privileged to serve as his pastor. Now, because of his personality and character, it was a joy to serve with him. Elder Mac was one who was easygoing and enjoyed a good laugh. Now, I didn't know until today what his middle name was. I remember on one occasion, one Sabbath morning, we were getting ready to go up for the 11 o'clock service, and we were in the pastor's study, and someone came in, and they referred to him as Billy D. And his response almost sucked all the air out of the room. He said, the D stands for delicious. I didn't think that was his middle name, but I didn't have the courage or the heart to ask him. But today I discovered his name, the D, did not stand for delicious. Nevertheless, on a more serious note, Elder Mac, he was dependable and trustworthy. He understood his role as an elder and carried out his responsibilities without drama and complaints. He worked well with the pastor, did not try to be the pastor, as some elders do. Did not try to run the pastor, as some elders do. He did not try to undermine the pastor. He did not try to use the pastor to promote his personal agenda. He did not run ahead of the pastor. He was an elder that worked with the pastor with the heart to do that which was best for the church. So his passing has not only been a loss to his family, his friends, and loved ones, his passing is also a great loss to the church and the kingdom of God. So today, we are here with saddened hearts and mixed emotions because our friend, our father, our grandfather, our beloved elder is no longer with us. We cannot hear the laughter of his voice. We can no longer see the smile on his face. His time with us, however long it was much too short. But I stopped by here today to bring you a word of encouragement, and that word is that those who fall asleep in Jesus are but waiting a wake-up call. In the early 60s, technology made it possible for occupants in the hotel to receive a wake-up call. Now, some of you were not born then, so let me just go ahead and kind of explain what it was. A wake-up call was simply a telephone call made according to a prior arrangement to wake a person up. The critical aspect of a wake-up call is that it had to be arranged with the desk clerk prior to one going to sleep. Here in John chapter 11, Jesus makes a wake-up call. In this chapter, he is engaged in ministry when he receives the word that Lazarus is sick.
after hearing that Lazarus was sick, Jesus continued to minister an additional 2 days in the place where he was. After 2 days, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let us go into Judea again." And there was some concern among the disciples because in that area, the Jews had recently sought to stone Jesus. But after some dialogue with his disciples, Jesus explained that it was necessary to go there because their friend Lazarus was sleeping and he needed a wake-up call. The reply was, "If he's sleeping, he shall do well." In other words, if he's sleeping, he's going to be all right. If he's sleeping, it's a good thing because sleeping helps the body recover from sickness. But because they did not understand that Jesus was speaking to them from a heavenly perspective, Jesus had to change his language to an earthly perspective. Therefore, Jesus said, "Lazarus is dead." Shortly thereafter, Jesus and his disciples make their way toward Bethany. And when Martha heard that Jesus was on his way, she went out to meet him and declared upon his arrival, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." In her statement is a clear acknowledgement that death cannot function in the presence of the life giver. But she also implies that the life giver had arrived too late. What Martha would soon discover is that Jesus is never late. And even when it appears that he's late, he's always on time. He knew the very moment that Lazarus would take his last breath. He knew the very moment that Lazarus was placed in the tomb. He knew the death of Lazarus would bring glory to God and present an opportunity to show the unbelievers that he had power over death and the grave. He knew that the hitchhikers called life and resurrection were rolling with him. So he says to Martha, "Your brother shall live again." In John 11, 24 and 25, Martha says unto him, "I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Martha's response shows that she had some knowledge of the resurrection, but her understanding was incomplete. She had a limited knowledge of resurrectionology. Now, you won't find that in any book. I imported it from Alabama. She saw the resurrection simply as an event that would take place on the last day. What she failed to understand was that the resurrection was not based on an event. It was based on a person. And Jesus said unto her, "I am the resurrection and the life. And he that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live." In other words, Jesus is saying, and this is the WJB version, Jesus is saying, "I am the 24/7 desk clerk on duty that gives wake-up calls." After her conversation with Jesus, Martha goes and tells her younger sister Mary that Jesus is on his way. Upon hearing those words, Mary goes out to meet Jesus. Those who had come to comfort her assumed that she was going to the gravesite, so they followed her. When Mary got to Jesus, she fell at his feet weeping and repeating the words of her sister, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Soon the atmosphere was filled with weeping, and in the midst of their weeping, Jesus asked the question, "Where have you laid him?" So they leave that particular place and they go to the grave site of Lazarus. Lazarus had been buried in a cave, and the cave had been sealed with a stone. And Jesus said to them, "Take away the stone." Hearing this, Martha said, "Lord, by now he stinks, for he has been dead 4 days." Martha was still speaking from her limited knowledge of resurrectionology. The only thing she expected to come from the tomb was the smell of her brother's decaying body. She had no idea of what was about to happen. After they removed the stone from the tomb, Jesus gave Lazarus a wake-up call. He said with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come forth." And Lazarus came forth from the grave. Now, that in itself is amazing, but what's more amazing is not only did Lazarus come forth from the grave, but it was the right Lazarus. There were other Lazarus in the grave, but the right Lazarus came forth. There were other Lazarus buried in Bethany, but the right Lazarus came forth. The Lazarus who was the brother of Mary and Martha, the Lazarus whom he loved, the Lazarus whom had been scheduled for a wake-up call, came forth from the grave. And I don't know about you, but brothers and sisters, but that's good news to me, because it says to me that it doesn't matter how long one has been in the grave. It can be 4 days, 4 years, 4,000 or 4 million years. Jesus still has the power to give them a wake-up call. Ever since the death of Abel, men and women have been in their graves waiting on a wake-up call. Men and women have fallen asleep in Jesus. On March 9th, Elder Billy McAdoo went to sleep. And I just believe that prior to going to sleep, he checked in with heaven's on duty desk clerk and scheduled a wake-up call. So today we are here with sad hearts, because for us, Elder McAdoo's life story came to an abrupt end. But I'm here to remind some and inform others that there is a sequel to Elder Mac's life story, that there is a part two of his life story, and is scheduled to be aired on the Lifetime Network. Season one ended with Elder Mac falling asleep, but in season two, his scriptwriter and producer, Jesus the Christ, has written in the script a wake-up call. For the script says in 1 Thessalonians 4:16, "For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first." I'm talking about a wake-up call. The script says in Psalms 49:15, "But my God will redeem my soul from the power of the grave, for he shall receive me." I'm talking about a wake-up call. For the script says in 1 Corinthians 15:51, "Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trump shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed." I'm talking about a wake-up call. Right now, those of us who are alive and living, we are living in the pre-wake-up call. The pre-wake-up call era. Those who receive a wake-up call will wake up to all things new. Our bodies will be made new. On this side of the wake-up call, we are sown in corruption. But on the other side of the wake-up call, we are raised in incorruption. On this side of the wake-up call, we are sown in dishonor. But on the other side of the wake-up call, we are raised in glory. On this side of the wake-up call, we are sown in weakness. But on the other side of the wake-up call, we are raised in power. On this side of the wake-up call, we are sown in a natural body. But on the other side of the wake-up call, we are raised with a spiritual body. On this side of the wake-up call, we are subject to sickness. We are subject to sorrow. We are subject to sadness. We are subject to pain. We are subject to death. But on the other side of the wake-up call, there will be no more sickness. sickness. There will be no more sorrow. There will be no more pain. No more trips to the hospital. No more trips to the funeral home. No need to make any more funeral arrangements. No more trips to the cemetery. For the former things would have passed away. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. So be encouraged, family. Be encouraged, friends. Do not sorrow as those who have no hope, for there shall be, it will be, it must be, it is written in the script that there will be a wake-up call. And when that wake-up call is given, all of God's people who have fallen asleep in Him, they will come up from the grave, never to die again. Be encouraged. Be encouraged. And look forward to the day when our Lord and Savior shall give the wake-up call.
I want to be ready for the wake-up call. What about you? It won't be long. I tell you, Elder Black has turned this service into a celebration for the wake-up call. And I believe he has finished in time for us to make the next appointment on time. If we move real fast, we want to ask those who are going to the cemetery, would you please do your fellowshipping after we come back from the cemetery for the fellowship dinner. But for now, the funeral directors are coming, and we need to follow their directions. Family, God is with you. So just be faithful for the wake-up call. God bless you. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ will be raised again. What a day, Lord, what a day. We want you to be our shepherd. We'll follow you wherever you lead. You promise life everlasting. Thank you.
Thank you.